This is the geostatistical module. I call it geostatistical appraisal. This is, as I mentioned earlier, the spatial aspect of statistics with its own challenges and benefits that come into play. It's also highly related to the misclassification ellipse we just saw. We'll see how that's used in environment, mining, and other industries. It's near and dear to my heart because it was developed in the mining industry, and therefore, that was kind of my first love, so to speak, statistically. Now, I came across this great quote, I thought, from John Glenn. He said, "I can see the whole state of Florida just laid out like on a map." And here we can see the state of Florida from space, which we've only had that opportunity to have space photos in the last 50 years or so. And he was up there in his little capsule, which I don't think I could ever do. But he saw it. And he said that in 1962 when I was, you know, doing geostatistics in the 80s, 90s, and beyond. I thought, wow, you know, there was a time when people didn't see this stuff, you know. And there was a time when we didn't have Rand McNally, where we could look at the shape of Florida on a map. And then my kids are going to say, wow, there was a time you didn't have GPS, you know. I'm feeling old. But it was an interesting concept because it got me thinking, because I was dealing in the reliability of data and the reliability of data on a map. Because miners were producing maps of where the ore was and where the ore was not. And I was starting to do maps of where the contamination was in the environment and where the contamination was not. And I could tell there were errors in those maps. Okay? And the statistics told me there were errors in those maps. Now, of course, if I knew where they were, I'd fix them, but I didn't. And so I was trying to reconcile all this. And I got to thinking, you know, it's kind of like going out on a hike and you've got your contour map from the USGS and you're walking toward the cliff, you know, which is straight down, and it's getting dark, and you don't have a flashlight, and you're saying, you know, what if this map is wrong? It's like, oh my gosh, what a concept. I mean, we trust maps, you know, because we have satellite photos, we have GPS, Rand McNally, and so on. But what if that map is wrong? And then I got to thinking, well, that's all I do all day. I make computer maps. What if those maps are wrong? And sometimes the mines call us up and say, hey, our maps weren't right. We used your software. You know, what's going on? So that's a problem because that's my business. And how do I fix that? And so it was a very fundamental question, a long way around from John Glenn. But I had to go to the map and say, all right, so what do? I start with sample data. I've got a facility which has got a big source area, you see by the big red dot, and then a couple of monitoring wells show that contamination is spreading down gradient toward the southeast. Then we have a couple of monitoring wells on the edge of the property, about four of them that are showing clean. Everybody knows what's going to happen. Eventually these are going to turn up dirty. But where is the boundary? Maybe the boundary of the facility is actually in here, okay, somewhere. And we want to know, when does the plume cross the boundary? When does it get off site? How do we make that decision? What do? Well, we probably make a contour map. Okay? Aha. Beautiful. Computer made it. What could be better? You know, garbage in, garbage out, they say. Okay? It's worse. With the computer, people say garbage in, gospel out. The computer did it. Okay, so now we live in a time where we become so confident in what computers can do because, you know, we have smartphones and blah, blah, blah. We trust them. Okay? But if your data are not good or just insufficient, then we really don't know. Who's to say that this 2,000 part per million contour line really follows exactly where the computer said it did? Okay? I wouldn't trust it completely. And, you know, why do we suddenly get this little dip, okay, out here? Why? Data didn't dip. Did you see the data dip? I didn't see the data dip. The computer thinks the data dips. Okay? Is that an error? I don't know. It's certainly interesting. So all of a sudden you start worrying about your maps. And you should, to a certain extent. So what do? Sometimes we make a fancier map. I say, okay. Okay. You know, I'll go even more high tech. I will make a three-dimensional or set of a 3D mesh type diagram, excuse me, and see if I can convince him that way. And so here we have it. But I really don't trust this any more than I did the original contour map, because I still have the same questions. It's simply taking the contour map, kind of like a slinky, going and lifting it off the paper and looking at it in perspective. Okay, there is no there are no data added, or in a sense value added, except from a visual standpoint. Okay, now from a mining engineer, if this is say a gold ore deposit, I want to say, well, you know, here's the area I want to mine. I want to get all this hot stuff out. And as a regulator, you want to say, I want to get this source area remediated. Okay, and so we can take a different form of mapping. Okay, instead of drawing these nice smooth contour lines, someone I heard called an educated elbow. Okay, we make a block maps. You know, and so I have a degree in mining engineering, so I can say we're blockheads, and that, you know, we think like little kids. You know, we build blocks. We never get out of that toddler stage, and so we say, all right, here's the limit between the ore and the waste. Here's ore, here's waste. Here's ore, here's waste. Here's ore, here's waste. Is there a possibility that this is really waste and not ore? Of course. Is there a possibility this is ore and not waste? Of course. Okay. How do I know? Well, it turns out the geostatistics gives us a confidence around these blocks, and we'll show how that works. But we know intuitively that there are some potential errors on our map. And how do we go about managing those? And we do that through geostatistical analysis. Now, as I said, samples and the number we have of samples drives our certainty and our power in decision making. If we only have 12 random samples and I draw a map, I find that I have two samples that are considered land. And this is an actual experiment from this guy, Dennison, doing simulations back in the early 70s. And I have the ocean, the sea, up here. If I basically double the number of samples up to 25, suddenly I find a little island because I found four samples. And the computer decided that that's the shape of the island. And the land actually increased in size. We picked up a sample over here, but it stayed the same here. So if we continue this exercise, as we get more samples, we say, well, actually, it's not an island. It's a peninsula, okay? And there's a peninsula, and there's little other islands. There's another sub-peninsula off of here and little islands out here. And what he really did was discretize the Mississippi Delta and then randomly select these points at various levels and try and recreate it. Now, is this anything different than what we really do? Here's what's reality. We don't know what the plume looks like out there. But what we do is we go out and we punch holes, okay, either water wells or soil samples in the ground, and we try and collect data and then draw the map. Okay, with a computer, I might add. Okay, so that's what our task is. And now we all realize that the computer could be wrong, our data could be insufficient, even if they're perfect, which we'll get to that later. They may not be perfect. His were, because he knew what the shape of the delta was from the aerial photograph. Okay, and so the more data we have, the more we can refine it. And he did contours. Again, I'm a miner, I think in blocks. And we're going to go through a little exercise that, after doing this lecture for almost 20 years, I came upon Yahoo last week or the week before. They're doing the exact same thing. Okay? And so you probably looked ahead in your book. But as you get more data, the picture changes and it gets more refined. And we can start to see what's going on better and better. And we can see shape forming. Okay? Maybe even a visible pattern, looks like C-3PO, maybe, or maybe not, okay? So the idea is the more data we have, the more we can see, okay? We can do the same with Abe Lincoln. We can actually Krieg Abe Lincoln. But as you can see, we're not really sure where his ear, you know, begins and ends, his eyes, or this guy's got shades on. I never saw Lincoln with sunglasses. Well, this type of exercise did not go unnoticed by EPA, the group out of Las Vegas. They've had several names, whatever they are now, neural they were in the beginning. But the idea was they sent a data set that they had simulated. So they knew every point. They had thousands of points, and they knew what the concentrations looked like, which is the map you see at the top here. Now, they sent the same data set to a whole bunch of geostatisticians. They said, make me a map. Okay? That's it. Just make me a map. Didn't tell them how to do the geostat. They didn't tell you how to do the contouring, what algorithm, what decisions to make, blah, blah, blah. And here's what they got. Guess what they got? They got 15 different maps, or 12 different maps. Okay? Every one of these is different. Okay, these two got this little thing right. This guy, most of the guys couldn't find it. This guy did, but he got an extra one. And so you can go through these point by point. Here we've got a longer peninsula than we do here. And it's like, all right. I mean, these were very qualified people that made all these maps. Which one do we believe? Okay, it's very difficult to know. Here's a map we had from a project down in Dallas where somebody contoured a little plume. And somehow, even though we don't have data out here, the computer wrapped, or maybe it was a person, wrapped the contour line around this little point. This doesn't happen in real life. Okay, nature doesn't work that way. And this went through several cycles of agency and stakeholder review before someone said, you know what, you know, that doesn't pass the ho-ho test. Okay, but anyway, that's what we lived with for a while. So we went back to the misclassification ellipse and said, all right, I know I've got these little blocks, and I can estimate it's below, and it really might be below, and I'm good. I made the right choice. I can estimate above, and it really is above, and I made the right choice. This is the ellipse, of course, and this is around. We can make this ellipse by doing that scatter plot we saw at the end of the last module with the correlation diagram, okay? And so we can plot our estimated value, and we can plot the real value, whether it's above or below the threshold. And again, if we estimate it's above, but it's truly below, it's a problem for the miner because he sends that to the mill, and they waste time and reagents and crushing and all that. And they spend their money unwisely. They don't want that. Over here, they estimate that it's below, but it's really above, and they take a whole bunch of gold and they pour it in the dump. Okay? Now that hits them right in the pocketbook. Okay? They don't want that. But it's no different in our world. We don't want to make people clean up a site over here that's really not above a threshold. Okay? And similarly, we don't want to make people walk away from a site when there's really a health risk out there due to the elevated concentrations. So we can look at this ellipse and say, how do we manage the type 1 and type 2 error that's going on spatially? Okay, now we're kind of out of the courtroom a little bit, and we're into spatial statistics. Well, we're back to our maps. And when another group, Golden Software, makes Surfer, you've probably heard of Surfer, they did a similar exercise. You can see that they've got six different maps, okay? These two look similar, these two look similar, but these two don't look alike. Again, you got a whole new set of maps. Which is the right one? Well, the right one can be fine-tuned so that we minimize those type 1 and type 2 error zones. That's the right map. Okay, now we didn't do it on any of these diagrams or the EPA diagrams, but I'll show you a case study in a few minutes where we actually did that. And we could say we have minimized the type 2 errors, decision errors, on all these little blocks, and there were thousands of blocks in this PCB project that we did. How did we do that? Well, it comes in with the geostatistical approach. Geostatistics, at a first cut, is able to take the misclassification ellipse that we see on the left, which is of a certain size, and refine it and improve it so that it's narrower. And what you see that is that a narrower misclassification ellipse has smaller zones of type 1 and type 2 error. So you're making fewer misclassification mistakes. That's good. Okay? So we want to do that. Simply by using the geostatistical technique of variograms and kriging in spatial data, which could be two-dimensional like the plume, can be three-dimensional like in a soil remediation, you can improve your misclassification ellipse and make fewer errors. So that's one way we manage the error. Okay, you can see it visually on a histogram. You can see that we have a little bit of bias and we have a wide, very wide distribution that correlates to the ellipse. If you were to cut that ellipse like a salami, okay, you would see a histogram of the errors, something like this. If you cut the thinner ellipse, you would see a bigger peak. Okay, it's kind of like a Mexican hat or something. You can think of it that way, in three dimensions instead of just a bell-shaped curve. So this is what we want. We want minimum error. Okay, and we also see that we had a bias over here. The mean was equal to 50, when in fact it should have been 0. Here the mean was 0.12, very close to the true target value. So we got two things. We reduced the type 1 error and type 2 error, and we got a more accurate assessment of the mean. So we can do better. That's the good news. We can do better by using something called the variogram. And the variogram was something that is intuitive. One of my degrees is in geology, and it was instantly intuitive to me because I'd been in the field doing field sampling. And you take samples at different points, and you get a feel for what's going on. And I happen to be sampling a coal deposit. And, you know, there's thickness, and there's sulfur, the pyrite in there, and so on that you're concerned about. And what we found is that if you took a sample at one location, and you took another sample about right next to it, they had very similar values, whether it was thickness or sulfur content or whatever the attribute was. Close samples physically have similar concentrations. And if I compare these two, they're alike. If I compare this to the water bottle, this pair is not as alike as this pair. And this pair with a table over there is not as alike as either of these pairs. And if I compare this to one in the back of the room, maybe, who knows, could be anything, okay? And so there's the thought process. The distance between sample pairs relates to what? The correlation. There's a correlation between these two samples, okay? Now, I said earlier, sometimes a correlation's a problem. In this case, it's a blessing because we can extract that correlation and then use it, okay? Because kriging takes samples that are scattered across the area of interest and then interpolates in between. It's sort of a, you know, fancy form of computerized guessing, okay? And if it knows that these are correlated and there's information to glean and then incorporate in the estimation, we can make fewer type 1 and type 2 errors. That's how we narrow that misclassification ellipse, is by incorporating that correlation information. Now, the correlation information is extracted through a process called variogram analysis. And what we have on the screen is a conceptual model of a variogram. The idea is that the x-axis has the distance between samples. So here's close samples further away. Close samples are plotted down here. Further sample pairs that are further away are plotted up here. What we do on the computer, of course, because there's thousands and thousands of pairs, is subtract the value of one pair from another. Okay, it can be plus, can be minus, we square it, and that doesn't matter. And then we plot the variance, okay, literally the variance along this axis. It's a type of uncertainty. And so we see that as the distance increases between samples, the variability or the difference between the concentrations also increases, just as you would think intuitively. If you start with a known and you keep moving further and further away, you know, you're not quite as certain, all right, because things are heterogeneous out there. What happens is the variogram starts up, usually in a straight line, then it kind of starts decaying, and eventually it flattens, and that's kind of the conceptual model. So what you are plotting is the variability between samples, okay? So where was that correlation, okay? I said that was the useful part. Well, there's always a flat variance up here. Here's the population variance. Between this line and the variogram graph is the correlation. And that correlation information can be used during the Krieging estimation process. Okay, so we've extracted it during the variogram analysis, and then we input it during the Krieging process. That's why people sometimes get really, you know, hepped up and excited about using geostatistics and Krieging, is because you can glean that information, okay, and use it. Lower the type 1, type 2 error rates, lower the misclassification ellipse, and so it's a good thing. The other aspect that comes along with that is that there is a different variogram for every site, okay? Every site has its own unique spatial correlation pattern, okay? So you can customize the way the computer does the interpolation between sample data points in those unknown areas so that your contour lines and little blocks are as well estimated as you possibly can. And another feature is that along with the estimate of concentration, you get an estimation of the variance. So again, you're managing your uncertainty at multiple levels during the Krieging process. Now, one more thing before we leave the variograms. Variograms can be done over an entire site. We can just throw all the data in it. That's a good thing. We can see what's going on. We can also say, you know what? I think there's a trend this way, okay? Versus if you were to sample this way. And that happens in groundwater plumes. For instance, we're working right now on a PCB sediment issue up in Wisconsin, where the sediments that are in a river, okay, and along the axis of the river, there's a lot more continuity than there is across, because the channel is, you know, funneling the PCBs toward the center, and then the stream is sort of mixing and homogenizing them in a sense as you go downstream. So you can analyze the variogram, say in a north-south direction, and you might get this graph. You might go, which might be the axis of the river. Then you might look across the river and see that the correlation is a lot shorter, and it comes up to the variability cap of the variance at this point. And so maybe you have a distance of, you know, 1,000, 10,000 feet along the river axis, but only a tenth of that in the opposite direction. And so you can customize the error attributes for every site. And that's kind of the golden key and the allure of geostatistical analysis. This is an experimental graph of the variogram. So we have the model, which is kind of perfect and conceptualized. Here's what they look like in real life. They're a little messier, okay, especially out here. In fact, this is a pretty good one, to be honest. They can get really messy. And we can see that an interesting phenomenon goes on. We see that the graph rises for about 50 feet, and then, funny, the rate of rise slows, but not completely. And then it sort of curves out here and slows down until it eventually kind of collapses, or eventually this would level off too if we had more distant data. It tells us a lot about this variogram. For instance, when we did the Dallas Lead Smelter in Dallas, Texas, we found that right around the smelter for about 500 feet, you had rapidly increasing variability where the larger particles were coming out and falling, and you had a lot more heterogeneity. But then as the wind took the finer particles and distributed them more evenly out to greater distances, the variance increased but more slowly. So you had this little elbow or bend in the variogram graph. And it actually reflected physical phenomenon that were going on at the site. Okay, and so this is a mining example, but you could have two different mineralization events or two different rock types that you can literally see. All you do when you're doing the variegram is subtract and square, subtract and square, subtract and square, thousands of times. And to me, it's amazing that this kind of bonehead, you know, process can actually put on a graph some physical phenomenon at a site. But it can't. For instance, if we didn't have these last few data, and maybe they're anomalous for all I know, if this graph had gone down this way, as it often does, especially around smelters, I would tell you, oh, I've never been to your site, never seen of it, never heard of it. But I can tell you that the size of the plume is 500 feet, just by looking at the variegram graph. Because I know that as I start comparing the low values on one end of the site to higher values toward the plume, the source of the plume, the variance is going to increase until it reaches a max. But then as I start to cross the plume toward the other side of the plume, I start to compare these low values, we'll say zero, to other low values, to other lower values back to zero. And as I transcend low value on one side of the plume to low value on the other side of the plume, the variegram collapses. I can tell you how big your groundwater plume is, the width of it, just by looking at the variegram. You know, as a geologist, you know, small things make small minds excited. But I get excited about that because I can tell physical phenomena by subtracting and squaring thousands and thousands of times on the computer. So this is the value. And again, here we have the population variance. I can impute or I can use this correlation in the kriging to get better estimates. Okay, and I put this one up because I like old maps. And you know, in the old days, when they didn't know really how to survey as well as we do, and they didn't have as many trips and satellites as we do, they put little sea creatures, you know, mythical monsters out there because they didn't know. They knew there was uncertainty both in the seas and in the boundaries of the land out there. Well, obviously, we've come beyond that. And I mentioned earlier, kriging gives you an estimate of not only what the concentration is at a location, but of the uncertainty at that location. It's called the kriging variance, or the kriging standard deviation. And we can map those relative errors. For instance, we have in this area 20, or we have 30%, it goes out to 40%, goes back to 40, 50, 60, 70. So what we see is that when we're in the main zone of the data, we're plus or minus 30, 40% error. But as we get out toward the margins, we're up to 70, 80, and presumably even more, 90% error. Okay? And so we'll talk about that too, because that may not be a problem. It's part of the error management process. We've lowered the error down to about 30% at the interior, and at the margins, it's up here around 80%. But the key here is to say that we now can make a map of the relative error or the absolute. Usually people relate better to the relative error. It's a little bit simpler to explain because you can keep it between 0 and 1. Along with the error map, we can also create what's called a probability map. Okay, we work in an industry of thresholds, which is similar to mining because they always have a cutoff grade where if it's below a certain grade, you don't want to mine it and you take it to the dump. Otherwise, you process it. Similarly, we clean up anything that we consider a health hazard. And so we can take that threshold and say, I'll use that as a starting point. And I can take all my data and I can convert them to zeros if they're below the threshold, and convert them to a one if they're above the threshold. Okay, and then I can do all the variegrams, I can do all the kriging, do the little statistical magic, and say, here's a map of the probability that a given area exceeds our threshold. Okay, so we see here it's 10% chance of exceeding the threshold. that means I have a very low probability that there's anything dirty. Here I have 90%, okay? Again, 90 up here. Here these are low. Here's kind of 50%. So we can say here are the zones that are most concerning. I've got 90% probability of being above the threshold. Those are obviously targets for remediation and maybe further sampling, and here are areas where we're probably not too concerned about. So we're limiting our world a little bit, and we're putting statistical values on it. It's error quantified mapping. Okay, we've never been able to do this until geostatistics came along. Okay. The other thing we can do is make what I call a fat contour line. If we have an action threshold, which is your best guess, by the way, this is, turns out that Krieging is also a blue, a best linear unbiased estimator. And so the contour line really is your 50% probability of a concentration. But since we have a Krieging standard deviation, we can add or subtract n numbers of standard deviations and say, well, my best guess is the boundary of contamination is right here, but if I want 95% confidence, I can make a fat contour line, or a 90% confidence, whatever you like. Or alternatively, I can turn things into ones and zeros and make a probability map, which is the alternative way. Most people have gone the probability route. And the reason is our data underlying this are log normal almost all the time. If we go the probability route with the ones and zeros, we turn it into a non-parametric problem where it doesn't care what the data distribution is underneath. Okay? And it simplifies the world a lot. So you can do it either way, but either way is very useful. In fact, we're using the probability mapping in this project I mentioned in Wisconsin. And we're actually going to the 50% line because they have to dredge the sediments. And the dredge is, believe it or not, more inaccurate than the statistics. So we're saying, well, we'll probably need a second pass anyway. Let's not overdo it. We'll go back. And they're doing it iteratively. So every summer they resample, make sure they got it, make sure things haven't changed, and then test how well the dredge did. If they have to go deeper, they go deeper. So you don't always go to 90 or 95% confidence. At here, we're going to 50% confidence. And it's agreed in the DQOs that that's good enough. Here we have the one of the smelters I mentioned from Dallas Lead. Smelter was actually located in this area. This little blip has always been a little bit of an anomaly. We can't quite understand it. But the Krieging 50% contour line is shown by this thinner line showing the outline of the plume. They had, this is north, and there were generally northerly winds coming off the smelter, which had been there like since the early 1900s. And then we applied a probability or a fat contour line to see at 90% what would be the confidence or what would be the boundary by 95 or 90% confidence. Okay. And I forget, to be honest, whether they cleaned it up to 90% or the 50% line at Dallas Lead because it got into protracted negotiations with the stakeholders. This, by the way, was before DQOs. This was like the early 80s before they even thought of DQOs. Now, one thing that I call WASP wasting and that generally is called adaptive cluster sampling, okay, or I call it chasing the action line, is that the probability map we saw showed areas of high probability of contamination and low probability of contamination. We can use that information to structure our sampling programs, and that's really what adaptive sampling is. We can say, okay, I've got my probability map, and I can see just by the sample results that some zones are pretty low, and history might, you know, site history might verify that. And so the Krieging has already shrunken the misclassification ellipse so that it's thinner, and we're making fewer and fewer type 1 and 2 errors. So we've done some good. Should I go out on the entire site and next round and just cover it again like we did the first time? I say no, and here's why. If you're pretty confident from your samples and your probabilities that this is below, don't sample the clean stuff. Don't waste your money, okay? And similarly, if you've got a plume or something that you're pretty sure it's above the threshold, don't waste a lot of money finding the hot stuff. You're going to take it out, or you're going to treat it. You're going to do something with it. So don't waste your time. Where do you go? You go along that action line. You chase the action line, okay, that 50% contour where, you know, it's like, well, it's a flip of a coin whether it's clean or dirty, okay? You really don't know. That's where your decision errors come in. That's where the type 1 and type 2 errors are committed. So with adaptive sampling strategies, what you're really doing is taking this misclassification ellipse and making it not an ellipse, but more like an hourglass. By focusing on that action line adaptively, you can take those type 1, type 2 errors along that boundary of the threshold and get the maximum use of your sampling dollar for the buck, so to speak. And so if you focus in on these, you shrink the ellipse preferentially right in the zones of type 1 and type 2 error, okay? And that's what we did on the case study we'll see coming up, in fact, in a couple of them. Okay. One thing the geostat can do also is create what I call a decline curve. We can see, and this is similar to a power curve, we can see that as we have few samples, we have a lot of statistical error. As we take more samples, the samples, decline curve falls, and we have a lot more good decisions. You can see that not all curves are designed or are created equal. This sampling scheme, for instance, is not as efficient as this sampling scheme. So tomorrow we'll talk about field sampling designs, and we'll talk about why this one is better than this one. If you're in the mining business, you can do some interesting things, like say, all right, I can do a cost-benefit study, because I always want more samples, but it costs me money to get those samples. I also know that by misclassifying the ore, I have a cost. If I send waste to the mill, it costs me. And if I set ore to the dump, there's an opportunity cost, okay? But on the other hand, there's a sampling cost. So if I draw my sampling cost, which is really a line, pretty much linear, and my decline curve, which all this is done on the computer, of course, I can add the sampling cost and the opportunity cost or misclassification cost at every point, and I can come up with a total cost curve, which when I have few samples is high because I'm doing a lot of misclassifications. And as I add more samples, it falls, and at some point, I get an optimum. The graph bottoms out, and then the marginal cost of every additional sample does not cover the marginal increase in accuracy that I get during the process. And this could be mining, could be remediation, anytime you're extracting. And so, you know, the trick in transferring this to the environment is you have to sort of put a cost to the value of a human life. And so nobody really wants to do that. But, you know, basically we're using the same kind of tools of cost optimizing in the balancing the type 1 and type 2 errors with the gray region graphs that we saw in the power curves. And here's just an example, a little program we have on the computer. And see, sometimes it doesn't take too many samples. And so, you know, the old story is, how many samples do you take? Well, I say samples are like potato chips. They're kind of addictive, all right? You're never satisfied with just one. Every one you take makes you want more. And you're never sure you have enough until you've got too many, or you've eaten too many chips. So that's my lesson from life. And that you can take home. So, a few years back. All right, I want to show you a couple applications quickly. The first one is from Rocky Flats. this little gray area, you can see how big it is roughly based on, these are cars, it's a parking lot. A couple hundred feet in either direction. It's called the 903 pad. Very infamous. If you ever worked in DOE in Rocky Flats, you've probably heard of the 903. It was a storage pad for drums of plutonium waste. Okay, and here are trailers and things that were out there during remedial activities. The other thing to notice is this little ditch that runs around along here called the South Interceptor Ditch. And between the pad and the ditch, it's a very steep hill slope. And so this has hot stuff, and it runs down into the ditch. And they were very worried about water quality after closure. Here's back in, 40s, 50s, 60s. Here's the way they carefully put the drums on a 903 pad out in the weather. Of course, you know, they corroded, they leaked. We had plutonium-239 concentrations on the order of 158,000 picocuries per gram. Okay, the state limit is something in the, 50 to 100, but it's way below 158,000. So this stuff, scream it, okay? Naturally, they're worried about that getting into the into the ecosystem and into the groundwater and surface water getting offsite. Oh, I see. It's 1960. Okay. Here's part of the subsurface investigation. This was done in the late 90s, not too long before closure. See the mountains in the background there. What we did was use kriging to estimate where the contamination was, and we're coming off that 903 pad, okay? And I'll do a little bit more on this in another module, but it was very instrumental. We used both regular kriging and we used probability kriging for the 903 pad, and it impacted very heavily in closure activities because we did this huge model which took the samples, which were then kriged in a site-wide plume as well as a local plume around the 903, input to GIS, which had modeled soil characteristics, soil types across the site, vegetation zones, permeability zones, particle sizes, blah, blah, blah. And that was interfaced with a hill slope erosion model from Department of Agriculture. I think it was called WEP. So we modeled how the soils and the concentrations at any location for a given size rain event, 6 month, 1 year, 10 year, 100 year flood, would sort of erode the stuff down the hill slope and into the ditch. Okay, then we picked up with a fourth model, which was a water quality model, like ModFlow, or not ModFlow, it was a surface water program, which name escapes me right now, and we tried to predict surface water concentrations of plutonium after closure. It was a huge project. So anyway, the geostatistics was a major part of that closure effort. this case study was PCBs in soils up in Massachusetts. It was called the Resolve site. Its claim to fame was it had the most PRPs of any site, at least this was the early 90s, of any site till then. I don't know if it's been surpassed, something like 250 plus. If you can imagine 250 lawyers in a room, talk about a nightmare. Well, naturally, they can't disagree. What we did was we got hooked up with a head attorney that represented the PRP group to the EPA and said, all right, we're going to use geostatistics. And we're going to go for 90% confidence on a block-by-block basis on this site. And we're going to minimize the type 1, type 2 errors to 90% confidence. So we're going to shrink the ellipse. We're going to use that WASP wasting to hone in on the type 1 and type 2 errors. And we're going to design an excavation plan that is as close to reality as possible. And it will leave the minimum amount of contamination that should have been remediated and cost the PRP committee the least amount of over-excavation. And they said, go for it. And so, you know, this is the first time as a statistician that I ever felt I was driving a project. And I got daily phone calls from Chem Waste Management was doing the remediation. Are we at 90%? You know, are we at 90%? Will you write me a letter next week? Are you sure we're at 90%? Can you write me another letter? You know, and it was over and over. But it was just in the early days of DQOs, but we used the DQO process minimally, but the fundamental concepts to drive everybody toward a decision. And we went around the room. It's kind of like this. Can you live with 90%? Okay. You live with 90%? You know, around the room. Everybody said, okay. Those are the PRPs. Then we had to go to EPA. Can you live with 90%? Okay. So we had a plan. I mean, they'd been working on this for, I don't know how long, a couple of 3 years, I guess, when we got there. And so they had a complicated site. They had kind of a, they had kind of a source area in here. They had a water treatment area. They had an access area. And then they had wetlands around the whole thing. So the PCBs were sliding out here. And to some extent, ironically, they were more concerned about the wetlands than they were about the source area. But nevertheless, we went through the whole geostatistical exercise and looked at the number of type 1 and type 2 errors. I did what I called a type casting of error. What kind of error is associated? And we found out that around 13% of the blocks were going to be estimated as dirty, but were going to be removed. Okay? So that was as good as we could do to kind of balance. We were targeting 10%, okay, 90%. So we wanted optimally 10% of each. Well, we got about 13% on the type 1 error. So a little bit extra dirt got moved. On what was left inappropriately, of course you never know where that is, we're at 9.5%, pretty close to 10%. And we said, well, okay, we will get as close to 10% as possible on the type 2 error, subject to the fact that the type 1 error, what protects human health and the environment, is still above 10%. Okay? And EPA said, okay, all right. So, and the PRP said, all right, we'll move a little 3% extra dirt in order to get the deal that makes sure that we don't have to remediate more than 10%. Or too much more than 10%, and leave behind more than 10%, which could potentially be a risk. Okay, so we could see that the statistics, we had so many blocks on a level, this is by level, above the threshold, or I'm sorry, below, above the threshold, and total misclassification of about 22%. That's almost a quarter misclassification, you know. So if we hadn't done all this, you get the idea. For years, we've been out there, you know, almost remediating blindly. You know, we've kind of been guessing. We probably got the worst of it. In fact, we probably, in the old style, got more than we needed. But that's a different story. Now we have the tools where we can really define, and we knew we were 77% correct most of the time. Okay. Now, that was good, but it turns out that Chem Waste also wanted an excavation plan. Oh, you don't want a statistic? They said, no, you know, I got to tell the dozer guy or the backhoe guy where to dig. Oh, yeah, okay. We said we got this covered. Kriging is a mapping software. It's three dimensions. We took the surface elevations, made a 3D mesh, or really just a grid, and we took the water surface elevation. You can see how it dips off to the west, and we modeled it. They didn't have to excavate below the groundwater, so we said, all right, anything below this kind of sandwich, we'll cut out. So we went level by level and said, all right, here's level X. Okay, these areas are above the topography, can't remove those. Here are the blocks that you need to take out. Anything with a little, I think anything with a little dot in it has to be removed, which is basically everything on this level. Okay, this is near the surface. They say, that's good, I like that. Okay, and then they say, okay, let's go down towards, see what the water level's effect is down near the bottom. And you can see how, as you went down, the area changed based on the elevation and compared to the water table. They also said, we want to see it in cross-section, all right? Because there might be a zone where we have to go back to EPA and say, we got a hit. These are all, anything with a symbol is a hit. We might have a hit right there. But you know what? It's way below. These are one-foot increments. It's 4 feet, 3 or 4 feet below. Maybe we could leave that. And so there was a whole negotiating process of how deep you had to go where and so on. But we're set up knowing that these are valid maps. And so, for instance, these came out. You know, if there were like one or two down here, they may not have. But you can see that sometimes it goes down, then there's a gap, and you have to take it. You have to take it. You have to take these and these, okay? So every cross-section, east-west, north-south, every level, every elevation, they had maps. And in the end, it saved them a lot of money because you know about moving dirt. You only want to take it out once. And so they had their staging areas, and they had the plan, and they were in and out as fast as they ever could. And so, kind of to finish up, they did not have what I call geoart, where, not that this isn't useful, it's good for like a conceptual model. This map is very pretty, and you can slice it and dice it, rotate it in 3D, and the problem is it may not be risk qualified. And even though those maps I just showed you from Resolve aren't that fancy, because back then we didn't have much color, and we didn't have fancy graphics, but they were actually better maps. Even though these are kind of sexier than the block maps. This map was a project doing pH and soil in Texas. These were risk qualified maps. And what do you notice about these between the previous slide and the Resolve? You can't tell just by looking at a map whether it's risk qualified or whether there's confidence in it. And so you have to know. And Geostat does that. So, you've gotten a real whirlwind tour of geostatistics in the last hour. Spatial data require different techniques. We use variograms and kriging as a start. We extract that correlation, which is unique to your site. We found out that contouring is not as easy or certainly not as reliable as it might appear. We find that geostatistical approaches can be used very effectively to manage both the error and the cost on a project. And so, because I know everyone's probably getting hungry, if there aren't any questions, we'll break. But if there are any questions, please feel free. All right.